can you say in as much detail as you can about why you suspect there may be more than one culprit?
Well, it's really, it's simplistic, really, at least from our eyes from that standpoint. You have Mr. Derman's body in the garage, and it's the body's decapitated. And that, I've certainly butchered deer and things like that before. That takes a little effort to do that, even if the person's not alive. And then we have Mrs. Derman's body in the lake, 5 miles away, at least 5 miles away, down towards over on the Greene County side of the lake. And while it's possible, you know, but you've got two people that are separated now. You've got a woman that weighed approximately 150 pounds. We know she was killed before she was, you know, placed in the water. We do know that from the autopsy. Plus she was struck in the head. It's just very unlikely, in my opinion, that one person did that. You know, you might have the drop on me, but if you're going to kill my wife, or you're going to, you know, I'm going to fight with you. If there's nobody but me, you're going to shoot me in the back, because if I can't do anything else, I'm going to try to run. But I'm just saying, it's, once again, I use the term frequently, when we look at the totality of it, it certainly indicates to me that more than one person was involved in it.
Why do you think this crime may have happened, if you had to use your best guess?
Well, I think that, you know, the Dermans were probably targeted because of something that they had, or something people thought they had. Okay, I think that was it, and or some sort of extortion. You know what I'm saying? That didn't go through. I mean, the circumstances, all of which I can't discuss, but the circumstances that we have here, and their lack of any kind of criminal association or anything like that, two retired elderly people in an exclusive neighborhood that is not on any major thoroughfare. I realize the lake is open, but we're not talking about the intercoastal waterway here either.
And what would be your personal best guess about maybe the psychological makeup or overall nature of the person or persons responsible?
Well, I'm certainly not qualified to, but in the world of hardcore policing, I would say it was a particularly brutal savage that did this. Whether he did it as a result of self-preservation, or did it as a result of just pure meanness, it takes a certain level of depravity to throw an 88-year-old woman in a lake and cut the head off of an 88-year-old man.
Sheriff, I know you don't have Mr. Derman's head, but we know that Mrs. Derman died from some sort of blunt force trauma. Does that say anything to you that these people may not have used firearms?
Well, they definitely didn't use firearms on Mrs. Derman as far as the cause of death, but that doesn't mean they didn't use firearms to during the initial assault or something like that. But firearms, of course, leave evidence behind more so than ball bat or something like that.
I mean, there have been cases in Georgia where a perpetrator has sawed off a dead person's head to prevent law enforcement from retrieving bullets.
Yeah, I mean, I've been in this business 40 years. I don't ever recall a head being taken away for that, but that could certainly be a possibility. I mean, no doubt about it. I mean, you know, we obviously have evidence concealed, because we have the body of Mrs. Derman concealed, or at least very much attempted to be concealed. And of course, you know, throwing bodies in lakes and wells and things like that are all, that's always the purpose of it. It's not, there's no other purpose in that other than to conceal evidence and buy time.
there anything you're trying to protect out there on the lake, or will anything be roped off during the holiday, or is there anything that people need to be looking out for, or what is suspicious that they can call about? Or
I hate to be graphic, but obviously, or sound crude, but obviously we're still looking for Mr. Durman's head. I mean, if that scene out there is something like that scene, we need to know. I'm going to have deputies on Marine Patrol and Lake Sinclair and Lake Oconee, like we always do on Memorial Day. DNR, I'm sure, will be out there too. We're going to, this is a big case, and it's a terrible case, but the sheriff's office goes on. It's been there since 1807, and it still has its duties to do, so we're going to be out there doing our thing. They've instructed us that they don't want people trespassing on this property, and we, of course, will attempt to keep that from happening as best we can. We got to concentrate on what we know. Where we go is driven not by speculation, but by the evidence that we have. And evidence is not always, certainly in most cases, it's not some forensic thing. It's witnesses and records and things, some tangible things. And we can speculate as long as we want. York case. I found myself constantly wondering why people would get involved in such a thing. And finally, I got to the point where I said, I got to quit wondering about that, wondering about the evidence, and move on. And that's what I'm stressing now. We do have certain things that we know, and some of those we're not going to elaborate about. But that's where we're going. And I'm sitting here with court orders for records and things like that. And those are real things, not things that we speculate about what people do. Real things lead to real results.
Can you share with us anything about what Mr. and Mrs. Durman may have been doing at the time of this? By that, I mean clothing at all? Can you share what they had on?
I don't want to go into what they had on, but there's nothing, I can just say there's nothing unusual about what they had on that would make us think anything out of the way. I mean, she was fully clothed, and no evidence of any kind of sexual assault or anything like that. But there's nothing to indicate. I mean, they weren't, they were supposed to go to a party on Saturday. The attire they had on would not have been appropriate at that, but it would have been appropriate for what anybody would be wearing, around the home.
So I know you've been asked a lot about time frames and timelines, and I don't know if you want to share that with us.
My timeline hadn't changed. This happened Friday or Saturday, we think, and sometime Friday, sometime Friday afternoon till Saturday afternoon. We got about a 24-hour window that I'd love to neck down to 2 minutes. But
can you share with us anything as far as what you're doing now, new, or is it just hard police work?
We're just steady, hard police work. It's like I said, we plowing hard ground at Rockville with a dull point and a slow mule. And if you were in Putnam County, where Rockville is. A lot of rocks there. Of course, people don't know anything about plowing mules, and I'll be honest with you, I know a limited amount about it from being a child around it, but I know what a dull point is, and I know what hard ground is, and that's what we're doing, and that's it may sound comical, but that's what we're doing. We're pushing with proven tactics and proven methods to gather evidence and information in a case like this. And I'm certainly open to any innovative technique that there is, but we're doing it the way we've been trained to do, and our experiences has led us to do, and along with the assets and technical expertise of the FBI assistants too. I cannot go into the details. There are things that we found out that I can't elaborate on. But the main push, like I said, most crimes are solved by somebody telling somebody something. Somebody knows about this, and we want them to call us and tell us in some way what happened. It would certainly help us.